Hello everybody, back in the workshop again this week.
Hello and welcome.
I hope you've had a good week.
Hello and welcome to Turning Point Church. Thank you so much for joining us today.
If you would like to find out more about us, then please do contact us via the website, Facebook or Instagram.
Going to start a new series this week. We've called it Fight For It, subtitle How to Build Resilience. Fighting for things in life is part of being human. It's something that we have to do all the time, overcoming difficulties each day. Some difficulties being very small and easily overcome, some much weightier and much more challenging. I wonder what you are fighting for right now. What is important in your life that you are struggling against? It may be under these dreadful circumstances that you're fighting for your job, for your livelihood, just to make ends meet. It could be that you're fighting to restore or maintain your health. These much weightier things have much more challenging things around them. So we want to look at resilience as a quality that helps us overcome these difficulties. And we're going to look to the Bible and to find sources of inspiration and encouragement and teaching on how we might build resilience. But before we go into that, may I just set some context around the words that I'm going to use? Because the word fight itself has a lot of colour in it, doesn't it? I mean, it's got lots of different shades of meaning. There's a hint of the fact that it might be a conflict, an aggression, or whatever, that you have to overcome something with force, and that's certainly not always what we're going to be talking about. It may be part of life, but it's not always by any means the case. So may I draw a distinction between two ideas of how to use the word fight? They're not absolute differences, they're colours that I'm going to use, and I hope that you'll be able to run with me on these because they're the context for the conversation today. There's a difference, I think, between fighting for something and fighting against something. When we fight against something, the focus is out there. The focus is on the thing we're fighting against. It's something we do not want, something we're trying to avoid or stop. There may be very good reason for that, and there are times when fighting against something is crucial. But when you're fighting for something, the focus is kind of the other way around. The focus is on the value of the thing that you want to fight for, and it has an implication about how we approach the task of fighting. So that's the kind of difference I'm trying to paint. So can I just suggest some undercurrents of the word against and the word for? When you fight against something, and if that becomes a habit, becomes a part of you, there's something happens in us, I think, that changes our nature for the worse. If you're always fighting against something, that can breed in us, I think, a kind of aggression, because it's always the case that you have to push and shove, and sometimes you don't get anywhere, and it creates this frustration in us, and it can breed cynicism. It's always going to be like that. It's never going to change. It can detach us from the thing that we're trying to fight against, to the extent that we become almost hard-hearted about it. And indeed, we could end up being mean-spirited overall if we're always fighting against something, because you start to get into a habit of fighting against just about anything. Whereas if you're fighting for something, the value being a sort of internal thing, it can create in us a vision of that value that you hold on to. This is something worth fighting for. There may be ways around things, but you're actually holding on to that idea. And I think to some extent that builds commitment in us. It builds a kind of caring nature about whatever it is we're fighting for. It fosters in us a perseverance, I think, more than fighting against something. Because if you fight against something and it doesn't work out, you want to give up, don't you? Whereas if you're fighting for something and you hold its value, you don't give up so easily. So it kind of builds perseverance. So as I say, those are the colours I want to paint with around those two words today. They're not absolute, they're just the context for today. But resilience is the ability or capacity to overcome difficulties. And I think whether you fight against things or for them, resilience is a key quality in us that allows us to overcome and recover from the difficulties we encounter. So let me run that definition past you again. Resilience is the capacity to overcome difficulties. May I share with you a little bit of kind of psychology that I learned when I was working in management education? I want to show you a graph. It's called the curve of resistance to change, the response to change rather. Now this curve that you'll see in the screen comes from research over a long period of time in different contexts. This particular context that I'm showing you is around the idea of change, and it's something that we would use in management education to help managers and leaders know how to manage and deal with change. But it's applicable in all sorts of different contexts. And in fact, the original research comes from bereavement research. So this curve applies to us all, no matter our culture or our experience. It's a kind of inbuilt response to things that can impact on our lives. I'm sure you'll recognize, you may have seen this before, if you've been on courses, you'll recognize it a lot. But there are stages through which we go, no matter what happens in our lives, with change, whether it's good or bad change. The first thing is, it can't be happening to me. This isn't happening. It's just not there. That's our denial phase. And through this denial phase, we have just been trying to put our heads in the sand. But as we get through that, we start to get a bit annoyed, do we not? We get angry with the fact that we're losing something. We don't want to move from where we were to where we're going. We were quite happy where we were, and you've got no right to make me go through this. So there's a kind of frustration and anger builds up, and there's a resistance to what's happening. But gradually, we often kind of process this and get through that phase and start to see, well, this is what it's like now. The new thing is coming. So let's make the best of it. And you start to explore the possibilities, the exploration phase. And eventually, fortunately, most of the time, we start to see the positive aspects of that and eventually become committed to the new state. Now, please be aware, this is not something we can avoid doing in our internal selves. This will happen to us, whatever. It's a kind of physiological, emotional response to change. And in the worst case scenario, in bereavement, we might change the words, but we're going through the same thing. Now, it may be that in the direst circumstances, we don't come out of that into the commitment phase for a very long time. If ever, we may not restore to where we were. But in most things, we do end up being back up there and committed to the new state. So that's just a wee bit of what happens to us, irrespective. The thing is, resilience is the quality that allows us to shorten the time between the first bit of the curve and the last bit. It's kind of like what Fiona said last week, mind the gap. If we can close that gap, we have become more resilient. It's not an easy thing to do in many cases, but it's something that is beneficial to us if we can become resilient. I think the key factor in becoming resilient is the value that we hold to the end state. What is it that's at that end point of that curve? If it has high value for us, we are more likely to get there quicker. So hold that thought, because I want to go now to a piece of scripture that talks about this kind of thing. And this is from James, book of James. Jesus' brother James was a cynic and didn't believe in him at all until the resurrection. And James became the leader of the church in Jerusalem. So a complete turnaround. And James says this in chapter 1 of his letter, verse 2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. On the surface, crazy words. Why would anybody consider it pure joy to have difficulties? Well, where James is coming from is kind of where we're at in this conversation today, because it's about attitude. Consider it pure joy whenever you face trials, because the trials are inevitable. And the pure joy bit is the implication that if you're fighting for something that has high value, and the value that James is pointing to is the testing of your faith produces perseverance. And perseverance makes us more complete in some way. Now, over the next few weeks, we'll be exploring different ways in which that is true. We'll look to more scripture and we'll find more ways of expressing it. But essentially, we become more complete people towards the way in which God had intended us to be when we are persevering in our faith. Because it's worth fighting for, it's where we end up being a more complete individual. But why on earth should we believe that? What is James on about here? Why on earth should we persevere in our faith? There has to be some underlying reason why we would trust that. And I think we find that in Jesus' words. And John has recorded this for us in his book, in his gospel. And if you go to chapter 16 at verse 33, you'll find that Jesus said this: I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. That's the good news. That's what the gospel is about. That's all about good news. Gospel, good news. The good news is Jesus has overcome all of the difficulties that we might face in the world. And if we put our trust in him, he will carry us through. So you can try and build resilience by yourself if you like. There are ways in which you can be taught how to do this, that and the other. You can have mental exercises, you can have attitude training, all sorts of things that will help us build resilience. But let me ask you this. If you've been on those courses, or if you want to go on those courses, what is the end point for you? What are you aiming for? Because if we follow what Jesus is saying here, What we are following is the God who became flesh and overcame all the difficulties that we will ever face, and will be in us and through us. He will help build resilience in us. That's okay by me. I can't really say that I would rely on myself to become resilient on my own. But I know that if I hang on to what Jesus has said, it will help me. It won't make it easy, and I still can't do it. I still find myself falling and go way back down the curve. But nevertheless, I hold on to that truth that Jesus has told us. He's ever that he has overcome this world. So how in practice do we do that? Well, that's where we're going to go over the next few weeks, I hope. But let me leave you with just one idea that Paul, the Apostle Paul, left us with in Philippians. When he was writing to the Philippians, he said this to them in chapter 4. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. So if we're fighting against something, we are too focused on the stuff that's bad. But if we have in mind all the good things that Paul has listed there, all the kinds of things that we can rehearse in our minds and hold on to and look to, they will help us persevere. They will help us be resilient. They will help us overcome. I hope you have a great week. I hope that you will find something in your life that you fight for is something that you can ask Jesus to help you with. If you'd like to talk to us about any of that, please do contact us on our website through our email address. We would love to share our thoughts with you and pray with you if you so wish. But in the meantime, may God bless you. Thank you.